So, in case you guys didn't know, whenever I make a joke about the South, people tell me you can't make jokes about the South, and I said, I was born in Huntsville, Alabama, so I can talk about the South. And I also lived in this fine state, Arkansas, for a period of 2 years. I figured I'd come talk to this side of the audience a little bit, because everybody's going to be over there all day. I had a temporary assignment working for a small company in Bentonville. And for a year, my wife and kids came, and I went and registered them. I think it was Apple Elementary up in Bentonville. And I was talking to the registrar, and I said, you guys are kind of close to Kansas. Are you guys teaching creationism here in the school? And she goes, I really don't know. She picks up the phone, pages the principal. Well, the principal wasn't there. Like 2 minutes later, the vice principal comes in, and he's like 32 years old, blonde guy. He walks up to me and goes, can I help you? And I go, I was just curious if you guys teach creationism in the school. And he puts his arm around me and he says, I'm with you, brother. And I think we should teach God's word in our schools. And I had previously made a pact with myself that I would not let something like that stand. And I said, I'm so sorry. I think I'm going to owe you an apology. And he says, why is that? And I said, I don't think that that's how it happened, and not only is it not science, it's bad religion. I couldn't believe it, he actually turned whiter. And after about 2 or 3 minutes of backpedaling and apologizing, the two science teachers for the school walked by and he dragged them into our conversation. And the one lady says, evolution's a theory, not a fact. And it kind of went downhill from there, and I said some things that I probably should regret. I don't know that I actually do. And a week later, we got a call from the Rogers School of Arts. It's kind of a lottery system, and they said, your kids have been selected in the lottery to come to our school instead. Would you like to have them come here? And I go, yes. Thank you.
A miracle.
So a little bit about me. I'm an investment advisor representative. My company is a registered investment advisor. It's just verbal soup. It means I filled out some paperwork. Woo! Paperwork! The state of Illinois tells me that whenever I give a talk, I have to tell you that I have these designations, and then I have to tell you it doesn't mean shit. It's the law, folks. So, some other quick things here. We have, this is for educational purposes only. This is not to be considered specific investment advice to anybody. And please consult with your own personal financial advisor before taking any action.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, it skipped the fun cartoon. No. Oh my goodness. Well, it wasn't supposed to go away yet. God is against me. All right. Buy low, sell high, stay diversified. That's it. Yeah, pretty much. It's not rocket science. I don't know why that skips forward. Okay. I am now going to have Kimberly come help me. And actually, Kimberly, I'm going to come down here with you, if that's allowed. And, oh, now I've got too many. So now I need you to count that, and you need you to make sure there's $140 there. Because I counted it right before I handed it to you, and I just want to make sure. I only have an hour, so if you can, $140. It's the 50 throws everybody off because there's 150. Okay, what? I know I gave you 140. You must have 140. Oh, here, I was holding one. You're welcome. Having fun yet?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm so glad I did it right.
Yeah, okay. So, have we ever met before?
Yes.
No. Wow, yeah, I'm taking that out of your check. This is a real product that's sold to people. So if you want to go see some advisor and you're worried about the stock market, how much it might go up or down, they'll tell you about this product. It's called a guaranteed mutual fund. So you're going to invest $100, and after 10 years, you're going to get $140 guaranteed. Sound pretty good? Oh, it's great, you should buy it. 10 years. And if the market goes up a whole bunch, you can make even more. You're not going to, but you could. Yeah, that's part of the sales pitch. I'm just too far from the, there we go. Okay, they tell you it's a new product, best of stocks and bonds, yada, yada, yada. Bonds are AAA rated, they're from the government, stock index fund. And of course you make 4% a year, but you really don't make 4% a year. For those mathematically advanced, it's compounded, so we're cheating. But that's not the advisor's problem if they can't do math. And of course, the question that I always ask people when they do something like this, they give you a prospectus. It can be 50, 60, 72 pages, and there's a little page you tear out the back that says you read everything and understood it. Of course you didn't. It's like the Windows operating system license.
Yeah,
I read that. Oh, you're gonna stand for, hello. It must be an Apple thing. You're gonna stay in for 10 years because if you take the money out early, there's a 10% penalty. And people hate penalties, so you're gonna stay in. Can we make that go away? Is that allowed? It says, please contact Mark Love immediately. Or I can ignore this notification. Apparently I can't. There we go. The dog comes and says, let's change our strategy. You start fetching the paper. I'll start making the investments. So now this is where Kimberly comes in, and she's being very helpful here. Now, you invest $100, and the salesperson forgot to tell you there's a load. Do you know what a load is?
Extra.
Think bull. It's a load of... So you have to pay 8% to invest. It comes 8%. Yeah, so you have to give me $8 back. Yeah. I mean, if you really cared, you would have read the prospectus, but... now, the nice thing about this is, Kimberly, of course, will tell us, how much did you invest?
$100.
Wrong. How much did you invest?
$108.
No.
Shit.
Poll the audience. $92?
You invested $92. So I told you you're gonna make 40%, but you make 40% on 100, but you didn't invest 100. So you don't make $40, you make $37, so you gotta give me another three. We'll have this. Another $3. This is so much more fun. Let's move to the other side. Come with me. And the video guys are going, shit! Oh, that's much better. Either that or it's the Apple. There we go. We're almost caught up. Macarena, anybody? This worked earlier here. Tell you what, let's go up on stage. Once again, everybody, Kimberly. Woo! Oh, that works better. Or not. There we go. Okay, $3, thank you. Now, there's also an ongoing expense ratio with this. Like anyone who invests in mutual funds knows that there's an expense ratio. They pay a certain amount per year. The average in the industry is about 1.5, 1.6. This one's just 1.8. It's a little higher than average, but it's so good that you don't mind. So that's 1.8 times 10 years, $18 you owe me. Just wait till it gets going.
Never get involved in the morning.
Yes. And a tip, how nice. Now, the other thing is that I told you it was guaranteed. That's like insurance. So if you get insurance for your car or insurance for your house, you have to pay a little something for that, of course. That's just 1.5% a year. You're gonna be in for 10 years, so you owe me $15. Yeah, what the heck. Now here's where it gets really interesting. We told you part of it was invested in the stock market, but most of it's invested in a thing called zero coupon bonds. They don't pay interest along the way, they just appreciate in value over time. At some point, the IRS decided they don't want to wait to tax you. So every year, they calculate the tax. It's called imputed interest calculation. And they tax you on the interest that you have not yet been paid. So every year you pay tax on money you haven't got yet. And as you can imagine, almost nobody buys zero coupon bonds anymore. But insurance companies love to sell them because what they get to do is they get to keep the appreciation and you get to pay the tax bill. So that's just $8. Just. We're in trouble. 20 is good. Okay. So now what your total is supposed to be is $188. but we cheated on the 20. So thank you very much for helping me out. Give Kimberly a big hand. Lost all her money. So the big thing is that the money is guaranteed, the return is guaranteed, but the fees are also guaranteed. And you agreed to that when you signed the prospectus, so you're kind of on your own after that. Anyone ever been to the FINRA website? Anyone know what FINRA actually is? This is a quasi-governmentalish kind of agency that looks over the industry, and it's staffed by people in the industry. And they actually have on their webpage a warning about these products, and they tell you that you shouldn't buy them. Then they sell them. But it's kind of like on the side of a packet of cigarettes where it says, will cause cancer, and now they say, hey, we told you. So they have on their website that you shouldn't buy these and they're complete shit, but then they sell them to you. And the reason they do is they pay really good commissions because the money comes from you right to the salesperson, so it's pretty cool. Oh, it won't even work with the button. There we go. Let me get a couple of them here. Okay. So a friend of our family, a friend of my wife's came over. I don't want that one. All right, we'll just wing it. She came over one day and she says, Phil, I followed your advice. And I'm like, oh crap. Because the first part of the advice would be to hire me, which she just hadn't done. And she says, I bought a stock. And I'm like, one stock? She goes, well, not one share, one company. And I said, well, is this a closed offering or a continuous offering? She goes, what? I said, well, let's look it up. And we pull up this company stock, and here's what it looks like on the internets. And she goes, I saw something like that with a bunch of numbers, but I don't know what any of it means. Okay, well, that's great. And she told me that the stock is worth $1, but she got it for half price at 50 cents. That doesn't make any sense in the business world, investing world at all. So I tried to put it in terms that she could understand. She sells Mary Kay for a living. Nothing wrong with that, it's fine. And I said, when you do a party and someone wants to buy a starter kit, how much would you sell it to them for? And she says, well, give or take $100. So what does it cost you? She said, 50. The next time you sell one of those, sell it to them for $25. And she says, why in the hell would I do that? Now you ask the question. If the stock is worth $1, why would someone sell it to you for 50 cents? And so this stock was an open issue, and they can keep selling stocks until they can find suckers to buy it. There's no limit. And this company, I'll see if the clicker works. Oh, look at it, here's the stock. And this is the neat thing right here. This is a month's worth of activity, less than 5,000 shares transacted on the market in a month. She spent $5,000, she just bought 10,000 shares. So if she wants to sell them, she has to sell twice what sold in a whole month. And you can see the price here is under 40 cents. She just paid 50. If she goes to sell those, she pushes down the market. If she can find a buyer at all, she might get 25 cents back on the dollar. She's lucky. And this company is working on proprietary technology to harvest static electricity in the upper atmosphere. They take a weather balloon filled with helium and then connect it to the ground with a conductive cable. And they're gonna power cities with this thing. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know when there's the most static electricity in the upper atmosphere? Yeah, when there's a storm. Weather balloons don't like storms. They don't do very well. So this is just hysterical. So there's the weather balloon. It's contacted to the ground, and they had this lovely drawing. See, they've got this cable going up, and some people flying a kite, and the cable comes down and plugs in, and it powers this entire city with one weather balloon. And they're on the edge of figuring this out. And so the person that sold this to her told her that she could double her money in a year. So she was very excited. And of course, I'm seeing half a dozen red flags with that, of course. And I told her what she needed to do was contact that broker. Now, I'm a registered investment advisor, and by law, I have a fiduciary responsibility to the clients, which most advisors then ignore. But she was dealing with a broker. They don't have any legal requirement as a fiduciary. They have a legal requirement to give you suitable investment. Whatever that means, and it's never applied, so it's completely meaningless. I said, you go back to him and tell him to give you your $5,000 back because you figured out it's a scam. And she goes, is that how that works? And I go, you tell him to give you $5,000 or you talk to his boss. And then you tell him if his boss doesn't give you the $5,000, you're going to contact the state of Illinois and file a complaint against their organization. They'll give you $5,000. Don't worry about it. She goes, well, I can't. He is a member of my church. Now, just to make it even more fun, this woman was in the middle of a divorce, and her husband was currently in jail for embezzling millions of dollars from his employer, and I kid you not, he really was using the money for hookers and blow. And she refused to divorce him because it's against God's will. And she had decided to stop paying the mortgage so that she could have money for an apartment because she knew she was going to be foreclosed on. That was why she had $5,000. And this member of her church knew of her situation, knew her family, knew that that money was going to give her a place to live, and he took it from her. And it's all legal. Oh, yeah, Elizabeth Warren, right? I heard someone talking about her, and they were complaining that she's trying to be a populist. And I'm like, she's been on this for 20 years. This is not a new thing. Here's a list of some of the expenses. I'm not going to come back down here so I can see. Some of the expenses that you might, I guess we're just going to have fun with this clicker. Here's a list of some of the fees you might pay. When you look at a mutual fund that has an expense ratio that's usually published, it will not include all of these fees. There's extra fees that you have to pay that they don't have to list as part of that expense ratio. So the average mutual fund listed is 1.5%. But in reality, it works out to be about 2 to 2.5% per year. And so here's the effect that the fees can have on you if you invest $10,000. If the expenses are 0.1%, you obviously keep 990. If it's 2%, you keep 800 out of the 1,000. So that's the $1,000 growth on 10,000. Because you paid a fee on the whole amount. And so in 30 years, you could have 100,000 or 170,000. So I'm assuming most of you want the 170,000. And that's one of the really simple ways to make more money is to keep your expenses low. And I think I have a little graph there. And of course, if you live longer than 30 years, it just keeps getting better and better. Another thing that's real fun, insurance, life insurance. There's the huge system that it might help you accidentally, but the whole system is designed to enrich the insurance company. And I used to have a show on the radio, and I remember a friend of mine heard from another broker, and he says, you heard that Phil Ferguson guy on the radio? He goes, yeah, I've heard him. He says, we got to get him off the radio. And he says, why? Does he have information wrong? And he goes, no, he's explaining to people how this shit works. I'm losing customers. Ooh. People will tell you, and I will tell you, to buy term insurance. It's like buying insurance for your house, your car, but you want to cover it for a while, but then you may not want to cover it. Like, if your car ends up being worth $600, you don't protect it from collision anymore. You just might lose $500 or $600 if it gets total. Well, what they have this new thing is return of premium term, because the insurance industry knows that people have now heard they want to buy term. So they keep the word term, and then they add extra stuff to it. So it's return of premium term. So you pay term, after 30 years it ends, just like regular 30-year term. But in this case, you get all of your money back. If you are lucky enough to live 30 years, you get all the premiums you paid for 30 years back. And so in this case, a regular insurance could cost $538 or $16,000 over 30 years. The return of premium term is more expensive. But the nice thing is, you get all of it back. So you're out more money, but you get it back. And this sells like crazy. People love this idea that instead of paying $16,000 and getting nothing, I could pay $33,000 and get it all back. What people don't understand is the time value of money. And if you invested this money in an index bond fund, you could make $40,000 with the difference. Instead of paying $33,000 that you get back, you could have $39,000 that's yours anytime you want it. The other thing, of course, is that if you die and you get premium paid on your insurance, they deduct the $33,000 from what you got paid. So they say it in such a way that it's true, but then they leave out other little twists to it. Now, if you put it in the stock market, come on, you can make $101,000, $102,000. But they don't tell you that. They just tell you you can get your $33,000 back. I'd rather have $100,000. This is one of my favorites. People call me all the time, email me, they hear me on podcasts or conventions like this, and they say they don't want to be in the stock market because it's risky. Yes, it is. It's very risky. And it depends on how you look at it. In the last 45 years, as measured by the Standard & Poor's 500, the best year was over 37% up, and the worst year was 37% down. That's a big, big change. If you have $100,000 and you want to have $100,000 next year because you need it for something, do not put it in the stock market. This can happen. You have $100,000 one year, you have $63,000 the next year. However, if you are investing for the long run, keep in mind that the market is up 80% of all years in the last 45 years. The odds are in your favor. The compound growth rate is 10.5%, which means every 7 years your money doubles. So if you invest 100, it becomes 200,000, 400,000, 800,000, 1.6 million. And the other thing is you don't have to invest for 20, 30, 40 years. If you invest in the stock market for just 5 years, the range no longer goes from 37 to 37. It changes to plus 28 to minus 2, 82% chance you're going to make money. If you invest for 10 years, the range gets even tighter, and you have a 90% chance of making 5% or more on your money. So it all depends about the time frame. So if you need the money for a car or a house 2 or 3 or 4 years from now, do not put your money in the stock market. If it's for 10 years or longer, you should put most, if not all of it, in the stock market, especially when bonds pay next to nothing, and when rates go up, bonds go down, and you actually lose money. So I tell people to keep it simple. Invest in what you understand. If you don't understand, wait. Learn what you're investing. Use index funds. Use your critical thinking skills. I get great questions when I talk to skeptics that I don't get from the general population, which is another sign to me that people who are skeptical have a better chance at succeeding in some things, especially investing. And read this book, Common Sense on Mutual Funds, written by John Bogle. He is the founder of Vanguard Mutual Fund Company, second largest mutual fund company in the world. And Vanguard Mutual Funds have another distinction that they are actually owned by the investors. So if you buy Fidelity, which is the largest, and they make a profit, the owners, the family, gets the money. If Vanguard makes a profit, it goes right back into all the mutual funds, so you get to keep the profit. So that's another thing to do there. I was in the line at the grocery store. How am I doing on time, by the way? Am I good? I don't know. Started so late. What?
10:42.
Okay, thank you. I was in the grocery store and I'm in line. The guy behind me starts talking to me. He says, ask him what I do, and I hand him a card. And he says, oh, yeah, my dad died 2 years ago and left me $600,000. And my head thinks, But then the other part thankfully takes over and goes, don't be that guy, right? Don't be. And I just said, I'm sorry for your loss. And I left it at that, that's fine. And he says, well, it's okay. He says, I bought an annuity. And an annuity is a legal way for an insurance company to screw you and take your money. And he was so happy, and I'm just like, okay, I can't explain all this to him in the line at the grocery store, I'll just let it go. And he tells me, they gave me a sign-in bonus. That is, for 19 years, I've never heard of a signing bonus. And what they did was, he gave them $600,000, and they scraped off 2.5%, $15,000, and they handed him $15,000 of his own money back. And he now thinks he negotiated a contract as a quarterback for an NFL team. I got a signing bonus. They handed me $15,000. I could have done that. I could have given you $16,000. I'll see your, it's your money. And then he told me this was about 6 months ago, he told me in 2013, he made $30,000 on this $600,000. And I gather from this guy that he makes $30,000, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000. You know, he's an average person, working hard, making a living. And a sudden extra $30,000 is a big deal for anybody. And that's what he got, an extra $30,000. I didn't have the heart to tell him that the market went up 32% and he could have made $200,000 in that year. So he was very happy with his $30,000. And I'll just wrap it up. I know I'm a little early, but we kind of got behind schedule, but I can take questions if you have them. Yes. My condolences.
Right. I invested with a guy that I knew.
Yeah.
And he moved some of
them,
so
how do you get that out of there? You call me. Shameless self-promotion. I can work with that. The problem with Edward Jones and all these other companies, and virtually 95% of the industry is designed this way, I'll put it in another context. If you go to a Chevy dealership to buy a truck, and you ask pretty much anyone at the Chevy dealership, what's better, a Chevy truck or a Ford truck? What are they gonna say? They're gonna tell you, and you know that, right? You see the big sign, it says Chevy. When you go to Merrill Lynch, A.G. Edwards, Edward Jones, all these big guys, what you don't know is they have contracts to sell certain mutual funds. And those mutual funds pay them to sell those funds. They don't sell other mutual funds because they don't get paid. So when they give you the best thing that they have to offer, assuming they give you the best thing that they have to offer, they're giving you that because that's who's paying them. So they work for those mutual fund companies. There are a small percentage of advisors, which is what I do, I get paid by you. So once we get that out of the way, there's no more questions. I don't get any trips to Hawaii, any vacations, anything like that. So that's an inherent problem with the system, is that they get paid to sell stuff. And they can sell stuff that pays a 3% commission, 5% commission, 12% commission. So, what do they do? What do they choose? I mean, you know, daddy needs a new BMW. I mean, you take the 12% maybe. I don't know. So, yeah, that's always kind of tough. Anyone else? You guys are so quiet. Yes, sir.
Yeah, what about pay you?
If you hire me, you would pay me. Yep. I think there's a huge ethical difference. If you're morally opposed to paying any fee, don't freaking hire me. So that solves that. I had someone listen to me on the show and they said, Phil, you're doing what you're doing, I could do by myself. Absolutely. Absolutely. It's just like I could fix my own car, but I don't. I don't want to. I don't like it. I'm not interested in it. But if you know what you're doing, you read the book that I suggested, you know how the markets work, invest by yourself, don't hire me. You're set. You won't hear that from any advisors. But there are people that just don't want to do that. Then they should hire someone that works for them. Don't even have to hire me, but make sure they are getting paid only by you. Other questions? Yes, sir.
And so you mentioned Vanguard earlier, and it sounded like you were real positively disposed towards them.
I do love Vanguard, okay. And they don't pay me anything.
Well, you just make me feel so good.
Well, I had someone that had called me recently, and they had two accounts with $100,000 each. And they said, Phil, we want you to help us with this $100,000 account. And I said, what about the other $100,000 account? And I said, well, we're pretty happy with how that's working. And I asked them what they made last year. By the way, the market went up 12%, and they made 6%. And I said, you're happy with that? And they said, yes, we are. And I said, well, I'm gonna revise my contract, my rate's 1%. And I said, I'm gonna revise it and make it special for you, 6%. Just sign that and send it back. And he goes, why in the hell would I pay you 6%? I said, why are you paying them 6%? Oh, I didn't look at it that way. I mean, if you're just willing to throw money away, throw some my way. Other questions? Yes?
Earlier you compared life insurance, you know, money you invest in life insurance versus investment in the stock market. Do you personally have life insurance?
I do have term life insurance. And in about 3 years, when both of my kids are out of college, I will terminate my life insurance. You know, it's just like, if your car is not worth a whole lot, you don't insure it. If you don't need money from life insurance, you don't get it. I had a couple of clients that were both in their 60s, they have no kids, they have plenty of money, and they're paying for $500,000 of life insurance every year. And I said, what's this for? And he says, it's for her, and she says, it's for him. And I go, why don't you just take those thousands and thousands of dollars and go on vacation every year? You have plenty of money, you don't need to give it to an insurance company. So, yeah, it's one of those things. The other things that I don't like, long-term healthcare insurance. My mom and dad paid $5,000 plus per year for long-term healthcare insurance. So that if you get seriously ill and you have to go into a nursing home, they pay that. My dad had cancer and then a ruptured intestine and went into a nursing home. And their policy said the first 15 days you have to pay. Well, he died in 7 days. So they paid us nothing. We paid $5,000 a year for 20 plus years. And then as the real kicker, just to show you how human these people are, 2 weeks later, my mom gets a notice that the annual rate increase was 15%. And since they're no longer a two policy family, they no longer get that 10% discount. And so her rate went up 25%. She's like, what do I do? And I go, I'll give you the same advice I've been telling you guys for a decade. Cancel it, just stop paying it. Ran into a couple that had supplemental cancer insurance, and they were paying $250 a year. And if you get a certain specific list of cancers, they will give you some cash. And the highest one was $1,800. So if you got this really, really, really bad cancer, you're pretty much going to die, they give you $1,800. And they've been paying that for 20 years. They're paying out $250 a year. And if they get that kind of cancer, they get $1,800. So you could have had that money all along. Anyone else? Yes, way in the back.
Okay, so I have a question. Several years ago, there was this guy going around selling these life insurance, and I don't know real names for anything. But it was one of these deals where you put in, say, like $500 a month, and you can like immediately borrow it. The whole thing sounded kind of weird. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. I mean, that's why I say by term, anything that's not term or anything that adds like return of premium term. The next most simple type is called universal. And a very simple universal, as long as you pay a certain amount for a certain number of years, you'll have the life insurance forever. I'm okay with that, but they don't really sell those because they don't pay good commissions. The person is going door to door selling insurance, I'd be worried about that, first of all. But it's probably some kind of universal policy or a variable universal or variable universal life, something like that. And what they will do is they'll say, if these five or six assumptions all come true, and if you give us $500 a year, you'll have $100,000 for the rest of your life. What almost always turns out that one or more of the assumptions don't hold true. I had a guy came to me, he was 60 years old, he wanted to retire at 62 when he could get Social Security, and he had a $100,000 life insurance policy with a $30,000 cash value, which you could borrow against, so it's your cash. And he said he's paying $500 a year. And I said, someone at the age of 60 cannot get $100,000 of life insurance for $500 a year. And he says, I've been paying $500 for 30 years. So, oh, that makes sense. But his cash value was only $30,000, so it can't generate enough income to keep paying the fee. So I said, you have to pay more than $500. He says, no. We called his insurance agent, and he says, well, he contributes $500, and then the $5,500 extra that needs to pay the annual premium for his life insurance comes out of his cash value. So in about 5 years, his $30,000 becomes $0, and then he's gonna have to cough up $6,000 or $7,000 per year to keep $100,000 of life insurance. And this man is crying in my office because he was told that if he gave them $500 a year forever, his wife and two daughters would have $100,000. And now he has to hurry up and die, or they get nothing. And so he asked me what to do, and I'm like, well, the problem is if I tell you to take the money out, at least you have $30,000, and you get hit by a truck tomorrow, you only have $30,000, not $100,000. But if you leave it for five or six more years, you get nothing. I like the $30,000 in my hand. He said, let me think about it. He calls me a week later, and he says, I solved my problem. And I said, how's that? He says, I went back to the insurance agent, and we took it out of life insurance, and I bought an annuity. So the person made a $3,000 commission on his $30,000. So, anyone else? Oh my goodness, yes?
There's an annuity product that you can buy that once you make an initial investment, then you can, at a certain age, withdraw a certain amount of money each year, like a pension for the rest of your life. How do those products work?
Well, if you're talking about what they usually call is a single premium annuity, so you can pay a lump sum, say you pay $100,000, and then they'll promise to pay you $5,000 a year. Usually it's set by contract how much you can take out. You can't just usually, unless you borrow against yourself, which is counterproductive. So usually they'll tell you you can get X amount per year. If you go out and shop those very aggressively and look for competitive deals, it's not inherently bad to do. However, what you could do is invest the $100,000 in a nice, cleverly defined portfolio, and you can take out $5,000 a year of your own money and still keep the $100,000. One of the tricks that they'll do is instead of paying you 3 or 4%, or maybe 5 if you're lucky, is they'll set you up on a plan where they pay you 7%. And what you don't realize is that to get 7%, you have to surrender the $100,000 that you gave them on your death. So if you're thinking that your husband and wife and it's gonna help you out, if you die in 2 years, the $100,000 is gone and goes to the insurance company. That's how they were able to pay you 7%, because they know there's a chance you're gonna die and they get to keep the money. So that's one of those things that tricks people all the time. They go, why should I just settle with 5%? I can make 7% every year. Well, where does that money come from? It has to come from somewhere. There's a little hook in there somewhere. But things like that, you can get one that's just your life, or you get the money back, or you get half the money back. And often they make it more and more complicated. And so it's very, very hard to understand. There was a question further back. Yeah.
So I don't know how old your kids are now, but instead of asking about creation theory, you asked if the school teaches personal finance.
But it's funny because the two things I always harp about schools, what they should teach is personal finance is one. The second one is statistics. Well, they usually do enough math. And some people might argue with me, especially my physicist friend up front here. Calculus in high school is a complete waste because no one's going to use it. I mean, if you go into physics or astronomy, you're going to use it, and you should learn it in college anyway. But I think that statistics would be much better served for the average student because people don't understand p-values. They don't understand inflation. They don't understand compound interest. Matter of fact, I one time stopped in a gas station in somewhere in Arkansas, and I bought something for $3.34. And I handed him a 10. And for those of you who do the quick math, the change back was $6.66. And they were just mortified. I had so much fun, I was tempted to go back in and buy it again. The other thing that we did was when my wife and kids came down, we went to a mattress store up in Rogers, and we bought a mattress, and they pull out this long 24-inch piece of paper for us to sign. And at the bottom of it, it has a Bible verse. And you know, I don't see that much in Illinois, but in Arkansas, you know, a plumber has a Bible verse. And they have biblically based investing, which says buy and hold, and here's a verse, you know, whatever. So we're in this mattress store, and I kind of had this moment of divine inspiration. And so I asked the guy, I said, what's this here in the bottom of the document? And he says, oh, that's a verse from the Bible. I said, I know it's a verse from the Bible. Why is it on here? And he goes, well, that's what the owners want. And I looked him straight in the eye and I said, sir, are you a Christian? Oh, yes, of course. Like, you go to church? Yes, every week. You do read the Bible? Yes, of course. I said, you know what a money changer is? And he goes, I don't remember that story. And I said, you told me you were a Christian. Yes, I'm a Christian. And I said, okay, so money changers are people who used our Father's house to make money. And they set up tables. And Jesus found out, and he came in, and he started flipping tables and beating ass and whipping people. Right? He had a big old hissy fit because you cannot use his Father's house to make money. You, sir, are using our Lord's words to make money. And as a Christian, I am offended. And if it weren't for the fact that we just spent 2 hours buying this goddamn mattress, I'd walk out of here right now. So I'm going to sign this, and I'm going to hand it to my woman to take care of, and I storm out of the store. Now, of course, at this point, I'm thinking I'm pretty fucking clever. And I'm outside busting up, and then I wait, and I wait, and I wait. And 20 minutes later, my wife comes out, and I knew that I had been wrong. And I said, what took 20 minutes? And she says, he would not stop apologizing. He would not physically let me leave the store until I forgave him. He was on his knees begging her for forgiveness. And she finally had to say, in the name of the Father and the Son, I forgive you for your transgression, or something like that. And he let her out of the store. And I'll finish with that. Thank you very much for your time.